Welcome to Who Owns the Past, a special public forum supported by the Oriental Institute and Archaeological Institute of America, and co-sponsored by the Chicago Council on Global Affairs. The forum features Geoff Emberling, Chief Curator of the Oriental Institute Museum, James Cuno, President and Director of the Art Institute of Chicago, Gil Stein, Director of the Oriental Institute and Professor of Ancient Near Eastern Archaeology, University of Chicago, and Carole, Tortolero, President of Chicago's National Museum of Mexican Art. It's my pleasure to introduce Geoff Emberling, our first presenter. Geoff Emberling is a research associate at the University of Chicago's Oriental Institute and chief curator at the Oriental Institute Museum. He holds a PhD in anthropology and Near Eastern studies from the University of Michigan, and prior to his arrival at the Institute in 2004, he was assistant curator of Near Eastern art at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. He specializes in Mesopotamian archaeology and was field director at Tel Brak, a site in Syria that may be among the world's oldest cities. And over the past 2 years, he directed two salvage excavations in Sudan, recovering art and artifacts from ancient Nubian sites that were eventually flooded by the building of a Nile responsible for the reinstallation of several of our permanent exhibits and for our special exhibits program. And he is the curator and catalog editor for the museum's current special exhibit, Pioneers to the Past, American Archaeologists in the Middle East, 1919 to 1920, which is the springboard for this forum and is the subject of his presentation for you today. So will you please welcome Geoff Emberling.
Thank you, Carole. Great to see all of you here. And I'll just begin. The question, who owns the past, can have many nuances, and there are many possible responses. It can refer to the intellectual control over the past, who writes histories, who frames historical questions, who is empowered to give the answers. It can refer to the ways that groups assert connections of identity to aspects of the past. Or in the sense that I think will be our focus today, the question can refer to the physical remains of the past, archaeological artifacts, works of art, texts, or monuments. And it has become a quite contentious question involving heated debates among archaeologists, museum professionals, dealers and collectors of antiquities and art, heritage communities, and departments of antiquities and governments all around the world. Many of you in this audience will be familiar with some of these recent controversies, legal cases that resulted in the return of antiquities from the Getty Museum and the Metropolitan Museum to Italy, for example, or the question of whether the Elgin marbles should be returned from the British Museum to the Parthenon in Athens. Or to take an example closer to our own work here at the Oriental Institute, was the US military responsible for protecting the Baghdad Museum during the 2003 invasion of Iraq, or for protecting archaeological sites that have been looted in the unrest that has followed? These questions, many of you will know, were discussed in our 2008 exhibit, Catastrophe, the Looting and Destruction of Iraq's Past, that was curated by Oriental Institute Professor McGuire Gibson. Today, we're honored to host a panel discussion by three scholars who have considered these questions in depth. Before we begin the panel, however, I'd like to sketch out some of the history that still informs current debate by discussing the founding expedition of the Oriental Institute, which is the subject, as Carole mentioned, of our current exhibit, Pioneers to the Past, American Archaeologists in the Middle East, 1919 to 1920. The exhibit itself traces a remarkable 11-month, 20,000-mile voyage taken by James Henry Breasted, the Institute's founder, and four of his colleagues through a war-torn Middle East in the immediate aftermath of World War I. It was a turbulent time. British, French, Arab, and other local leaders were negotiating over the formation of what would become the nations we now recognize in the Middle East, and tensions over colonial control and independent local rule were rising. The story of Breasted's journey is told in the exhibit through his photographs, excerpts from his letters, documents, and antiquities that he purchased on the trip. But as the curator of the exhibit and as an archaeologist myself, I found many of Breasted's views, frankly, to be deeply problematic, typical of that colonial era, certainly, but very different from the way archaeologists and historians think and work today. Thus, the exhibit confronts some of these issues in the voice of a modern archaeologist, and I would like to raise a few of these now. First, I'd like to highlight Breasted's views on ownership of antiquities. Breasted was an Egyptologist who had a really remarkable vision and justification for why we should study the ancient Middle East. At a time when the common view was that civilization began in Greece, Breasted argued that, in fact, Western civilization began in ancient Egypt and Mesopotamia and the lands in between. And on a factual level, in many ways, he was correct. Civilization, he argued, had begun in the ancient Middle East and had then passed from the Middle East to the West. This is a view enshrined in the tympanum over the main entrance to the Oriental Institute that you can see on this slide. And what you can see here is on the left, representatives of civilizations of the ancient Middle East. On the right, you can see representatives of Midwestern American culture, some of them, including the state capital of Nebraska, among, as all of you know, one of the glories of Western civilization. And the idea being that the ancient civilizations are passing civilization onto the West. Now, this tympanum and this view is subject today to a reading that's not particularly controversial. Civilization began in the Middle East, it spread, and we're all benefactors of that. But for Breasted, Breasted read this differently. And for him, the past of the Middle East literally belonged to the West as a part of our own heritage. And in his letters, it becomes clear that he thought that people living in the Middle East were no longer civilized. So I'll quote a single passage from his letters, not to condemn him. Once again, his views were typical under the colonialism of the 1920s. Referring to an area that would become Iraq, he says, "The civil commissioner who is practically king of the country, Colonel A.T. Wilson, is an exceptionally strong man, has very decided views about the proper policy for his treatment of the country, and I fear has such a sensitive regard for what he considers the rights of the Arabs." Imagine Arab rights based on their appreciation of cuneiform documents. "That he may not allow us to take out a single thing. But I have a strong weapon against him in that British officers of wealth have already taken out great groups of stuff in their baggage as their personal collections." So you can see encapsulated there a strong view of Breasted's that, in fact, cuneiform tablets and other antiquities belong in the West because they're, on the one hand, a part of Western civilization, and on the other hand, that they can be properly appreciated here. And I, you know, from today's point of view, I would argue that this kind of exclusive claim on antiquities is problematic regardless of who makes it. So second, I'd like to highlight the kind of changes over the course of the 20th century in antiquities laws. Throughout his trip, Breasted and his colleagues made purchases of antiquities that were legal at the time. Breasted was not unique in making the most of this moment. As he says of some objects in Cairo that he wanted to purchase on behalf of the Art Institute, quote, "These pieces were bought by Dr. Gordon, director of the Philadelphia Museum, but he has now written the dealer Blanchard with such uncertainty about them that Blanchard regards himself as released, for Gordon paid no money. An hour ago, I learned of this, and mounting a borrowed bicycle for lack of any other conveyance, for I live in a suburb and the trains are on strike, I rode as fast as I could to Blanchard's place. I saved the bronze by only a few minutes, for Colonel Samuels, a wealthy British officer, was just about to pay the money for the jackal. As for the superbly colored relief, it will be snapped up the minute the Metropolitan Museum people see it, and they are expected hourly, for they have landed at Alexandria. Under the circumstances, there was nothing to do to buy these two pieces outright, and I have done so in order to save them for the Art Institute." Breasted was buying things not only for the Oriental Institute's collection, but for the Art Institute. So this was all done legally, but there was a kind of an awareness that the times were changing and that it would not be possible to do this indefinitely. But it clearly became a kind of unseemly scramble for antiquities. Breasted was buying antiquities both for the Oriental Institute and the Art Institute, in part because he wanted to raise the profile of Chicago as a city of international importance, which is a further statement about the cultural value of these antiquities. Breasted was correct to recognize that it was a unique opportunity. Indeed, the Middle Eastern states defined after World War I increasingly began to regulate the export of antiquities as they made claim to what they now saw as their own heritage. Breasted purchased more than 6,000 objects on his trip, including this well-known group of stone statuettes from an Old Kingdom Egyptian tomb. About 250 of Breasted's purchases are currently on display in the museum, identified by the icon you see on the right-hand side of the screen. He soon recognized, however, that the antiquities market was not as active in areas of the Middle East outside Egypt, and that he would have to start excavations in order to acquire antiquities for research and display. And there you see him in front of the Ziggurat of Ur and sitting on the top of the Ziggurat of Ur taking notes, considering whether this, in fact, was the sort of place that the Oriental Institute should begin excavations. So at the time, antiquities were allocated to expeditions under a system known as partage or division. In the antiquities laws developed in the 1920s and 1930s, foreign archaeological projects received a portion of what they excavated, and numerically, these finds represent the vast majority of the Oriental Institute's collection. We'll hear more about partage in the panel discussion, I believe. So it is relevant to mention that it was phased out across the Middle East by the 1960s or so, as Middle Eastern countries increasingly asserted their own right and interest in holding this material. Today, most archaeological projects do not bring collections back to their own institutions, except under unusual circumstances. So to summarize, Breasted made claims on Middle Eastern antiquities as a part of Western heritage and considered that these objects would be better appreciated in the West than in their countries of origin. Factually, he was not wrong at the time, but much has changed since 1920, and these views have not been sustainable, in fact, for many years now. So my final point has to do with the political importance of archaeology. Archaeology was a political interest, importance in Breasted's day in ways that are surprising today. It is striking to a modern archaeologist to read Breasted's letters and realize that during his trip he met the highest political officials and leaders everywhere he traveled. In Egypt, he was hosted by the High Commissioner of Egypt, Lord Allenby. Allenby was the general who led the British attack along the Mediterranean coast during World War I to take Damascus. He had read and admired Breasted's work, particularly his account of an ancient Egyptian attack at the site of Megiddo, where Allenby himself also won a critical battle in part by following the ancient Egyptian route. Useful stuff, ancient history. Breasted also met a wide range of British officials, including Gertrude Bell, you see there on the left, in the distance, who would go on to help establish the country of Iraq and to found the Iraq Museum. While traveling through what is now Syria, he met the Arab leader, King Faisal, who was attempting to establish an Arab state based in Damascus and who would go on to become the king of Iraq when things in Damascus didn't go so well. And everywhere he went, he met officials who had read his own book, Ancient Times. So why were these officials so interested in archaeology? Why did archaeology have this level of political importance at the time? It is worth considering in this connection why there were not, at the same time, Turkish archaeological expeditions exploring England or France, or why Egyptians were not searching for the source of the Thames as Europeans were seeking the source of the Nile. In fact, similar imagined projects remain virtually unthinkable today. Are we likely to have an Iraqi expedition to investigate the founding of the American state? No, we're not. And the fact that it's worth asking yourself, why does that idea conjure up a smile? And I would argue that these examples illustrate that archaeology and antiquities are investigated in an international balance of political and economic power, then as now. And further, that colonial officials were interested in archaeology and antiquities because knowledge of the areas under their control was an important part of the exercise of that control. So in closing, I do not want to leave the impression that everything about colonialism was exploitative and extractive, even if much of it was. To a significant degree, it was Western colonial interest in the past of the Middle East that put a value, commercial certainly, but also cultural and historical, on antiquities. And it was also out of that colonial context that national museums and departments of antiquities were formed. And now, with that introduction to some of the issues, I will turn to our panel, and what I'm going to do is introduce all three of them and then welcome them up one by one to give their own presentations. So first, we'll have James Cuno, who is president and Eloise W. Martin director of the Art Institute of Chicago and former director of the Courtauld Institute of Art in London and the Harvard University Art Museums. His books include Who Owns Antiquity? Museums and the Battle Over Our Ancient Heritage, Whose Culture, the Promise of Museums and the Debate over Antiquity, and most recently, Master Paintings in the Art Institute of Chicago. He has inspired impassioned discussion with his message that concern for antiquities should be dictated not by politics, but by the demands of conservation and broad public access. Our second panelist, you've met already, but I'll introduce him more completely. Gil Stein is director of the Oriental Institute and professor of ancient Near Eastern archaeology at the University of Chicago. His main research interests focus on the development of early civilizations in the Near East and the archaeology of ancient colonies. He has also conducted research on the economic organizations of state societies, craft specialization, Neolithic subsistence systems, and zooarchaeology. Since 2008, he has been the Oriental Institute representative at Tel Zeidan, the joint Syrian-American excavation that is deepening understanding of a prehistoric culture in Mesopotamia, which set the stage for the rise of the world's first cities and the invention of writing. He is a committed proponent for strong international legal frameworks to protect cultural heritage from looting and the illicit antiquities trade. And our third panelist, last but not least, Carlos Tortolero, is founder and president of the National Museum of Mexican Art. He is also former president of Chicago's Museums in the Parks, is an advisory board member for the Chicago Department of Cultural Affairs, and formerly a teacher, counselor, and administrator for the Chicago Public Schools. Mr. Tortolero is a strong advocate for the return of select major artworks and artifacts to their countries of origin. So with that lineup, I'd like to invite James Cuno to the stage, and we'll carry on. Thank you very much. Now you're all set.
Thank you very much, Geoff, and also to thank you, Gil. It's a great honor to be here with you on this occasion and on the occasion that accompanies this spectacular exhibition. Now, I'm a director of with representative examples of most of the world's visual cultures in our collections. Such museums are dedicated to the proposition that by introducing our visitors to works of art from different cultures, we are helping to dissipate ignorance and superstition about the world and promote inquiry and tolerance of difference itself. This I hold to be important, especially here in Chicago, for Chicago is, and always has been, a city of immigrants. Some 22% of our population is foreign-born, which is twice the national average, and we have more than 26 ethnic groups of greater than 25,000 members each, with more than 40 languages spoken in our city by at least 1,000 people each. By introducing our visitors to artifacts of the world's diverse cultures, we are not only introducing them to cultures distant from themselves in time and space, but increasingly, as immigrants continue to move into our city, we are introducing Chicago residents to the historic cultures of their new neighbors. Now, encyclopedic art museums are cosmopolitan institutions dedicated to the presentation of works of art from the world's many cultures without prejudice. In this, they aspire to the condition of cosmopolitanism as articulated by the Roman Emperor Marcus Aurelius, who famously urged his readers not to forget, in his words, the closeness of man's brotherhood with his kind, a brotherhood not of blood or human seed, but of a common intelligence. Or by the 18th century British philosopher David Hume, who saw the cosmopolite as, in his words, a creature whose thoughts are not limited by any narrow bounds, either of place or time. Or indeed by the Indian Nobel Prize winner and nationalist Rabindranath Tagore, who in 1908 wrote in a letter to a friend, "Patriotism cannot be our final spiritual shelter. My refuge is humanity." Well, this is especially important in the United States, given our powerful position in the world and our tendency to nationalist triumphalism and essentialist interpretations of national cultural identities. What it means to be an American is constantly debated. Witness the continuing attacks on President Obama as not being legally our president, because it is said that he was born outside the U.S. to an Islamic African father, when in fact he was born in Hawaii, a U.S. state at the time, and from birth has been a U.S. citizen. Those who disagree with President Obama's policies, or do not like the fact that someone of his race, with his mixed background, and it is said with his un-American name, argue that he is not really American, not one of us. We may not have a ministry of immigration and national identity, as the French have, nor have we initiated a formal grand debate on our national identity as President Sarkozy has, but we debate it all the time, often through surrogate issues like national health care, abortion, same-sex marriage, immigration rights, and the proper role of government in our lives. While I acknowledge the important role of nationalism in forging opportunities of self-determination, I am a critic of its tendency to harden into ideological positions with roots in fear and hatred of the other, often with racist affinities. As Ernst Gellner reminds us, nationalism is a theory of political legitimacy which requires that ethnic boundaries should not cut across political ones. This means that there are many more potential nations than there are possible viable states, because many of the world's potential nations live, or until recently have lived, not in compact territorial units, but intermixed with other nations in complex patterns. It then follows that a territorial political unit can only become ethnically homogeneous, in such cases only if, in Gellner's words, it either kills or expels or assimilates all non-nationals. We've witnessed violent incidents of such activity in the Balkans and Rwanda during the 1990s, among Hindus and Muslims in India since the destruction of the Ayodhya Mosque by Hindu nationalists in 1992, and more recently in Timor, the Sudan, Darfur, and Iraq. I question the legitimacy, indeed the sincerity, of modern governments to claim descent from ancient cultures with archaeological remains within their jurisdiction. Once again, I can understand the role that this has played in the formation of modern states, as presented so clearly in the catalog to the current exhibition, but it too gets abused when modern state governments exaggerate these claims, use them to distinguish one nation from another. One nation is older, more powerful, essentialized. Iraq under Saddam Hussein, who used ancient Mesopotamian remains to claim a continuity of grandness for Iraq, greater than that of Egypt, his rival in the Arab world. Or China, which funds the Xia Shang Zhou chronology project to establish exact dates for China's early cultures. Some have criticized that project as being politically motivated, but its director, Liu Shexin, disagrees. He says, "We just want to figure out how China developed. It's no different from studying ancient Greece or Egypt. These other ancient cultures have all been studied more than China, and China has a special characteristic. It still exists where the others have all disappeared." Or Italy, whose government claimed in a special request to the US government to restrict the import of antiquities on the grounds that these materials, this is the words of the request, these materials are of cultural significance because they derive from cultures that developed autonomously in the region of present-day Italy, and that the cultural patrimony represented by these materials is a source of identity and esteem for the modern Italian nation. Autonomous to the region of modern-day Italy? The dependency of Roman culture on earlier Greek culture was such that, as the Harvard classicist Emma Dench has recently written, Romans, in her words, located themselves in relation to the Greeks, and the dichotomy between Romans and Greeks didn't so much describe or prescribe behavior, talents, or tendencies as assign roles in the management and manipulation of power. The tendency to claim and police national cultural identity is a political act. It is what governments do, not what people do. And governments do this and argue about it and legislate it to confirm their place in power. Encyclopedic art museums work to hold the question of national cultural identity in suspension, arguing instead by the evidence of the artifacts in their collections that culture has never known national borders, that it has always flourished through contact with new and strange cultural manifestations, and that it has always been hybrid, mongrel, a bricolage of different cultural impressions. They encourage what the South Asian historian David Ludden has described as a shift from the stasis of civilizational histories with their boundaries and boundedness and closures to a more dynamic emphasis on networks of encounter and exchange. The idea of civilization, he writes, necessarily, if not intentionally, indices a reading back of present national sentiments into a timeless past. It thereby prevents history from working against cultural hegemonies in the present by stultifying our analysis of mobility, context, agency, contingency, and change. This is the dynamic truth about culture now and in the past. One object alone is enough to make this clear. This limestone capital in the Metropolitan Museum of Art is from South Italy, Apulia, probably Troia, and it dates from the early 13th century. It includes the features of four different racial types. The one in the foreground of this image is meant to represent an African. And it reminds us of the melange of cultural context in South Italy and Sicily during the Middle Ages. In 863, for example, a monk named Theodosius wrote of the grandeur of Palermo, describing it as, in his words, full of citizens and strangers, blended with the Sicilians, the Greeks, the Lombards, and the Jews, There are Arabs, Berbers, Persians, Tartars, Negroes, some wrapped in long robes and turbans, faces oval, square, or round, of every complexion and profile, beards and hair of every variety of color and cut. And with all of these different people came their different cultures, of course, and these cultures inspired new forms of cultural expression. This is what encyclopedic museums celebrate, recognition of hybridity as the true condition of culture. Governments and the nationalist politics they encourage through the imposition and policing of retentionist cultural property laws propagate a false ideology of cultural essentialism and cultural purity when none exists naturally. If we are to be true to the condition of culture, and if we wish to address ignorance and superstition about the world and promote inquiry and tolerance of difference itself, we need to encourage broader access to the world's cultures through an extensive program of legal trade in or long-term loan of or lease of artifacts representative of the world's cultural legacy. For as the Indian economic journalist Sanjay Subramaniam has written, a national culture that does not have the confidence to declare that, like all other national cultures, it too is a hybrid, a crossroads, a mixture of elements derived from chance encounters and unforeseen consequences, can only take the path to xenophobia and cultural paranoia, a path I think we can all agree that is littered with the tragedies of sectarian violence, ethnic cleansing, and social and racial discrimination. Thank you.
I think we all have to recognize that scholarship, the law, politics, and our collective sense of ethics have all evolved over the last century and continue to evolve. You've heard Geoff Emberling give a very fine example of that in discussing James Henry Breasted's attitudes towards collecting, his attitudes towards the peoples of the areas in the Near East where he traveled at the end of World War I. You also heard him summarize the very important series of developments that have taken place in this evolving structure, and it's an interrelated structure of law, politics, and a collective sense of ethics. Over time, as national institutions have developed in the countries of the Near East especially, but also we can say in Africa and Asia and South Asia as well, there has been an evolution, a building of national institutions, of departments of antiquities, of university systems, of national museums in all of these places. That sense of that the importance of these national institutions and their growth is something that we all need to remember. We also need to remember that the world and its balance of power is constantly shifting, and that while one might have described the 20th century as the American century, we don't know whose century the next one is going to be. And therefore, it behooves us to be very aware and very sensitive to the fact that there cannot be one law for the rich and the powerful and another law for the weak and the poor. That very certainly, whatever laws we try to impose will be imposed on us in return at some point in the future. And that's an extremely important principle to bear in mind. The United States has an extremely honorable reputation in this regard. There are many things that we can be proud of as a country. Our Constitution is one, with its respect for minority rights. A second is a lesser known story that many of you may have seen in a documentary called The Rape of Europa. It has to do with the efforts of the United States Army and the United States government at the end of World War II to locate and return the works of art that were stolen by the Nazis, either from the Jews that they murdered or from the countries that they conquered. And the Nazis were very, very systematic about looting art from the countries that they conquered. One of the great things and little known stories of World War II is the way our government decided to send art historians, art historical experts out with the United States forces in Europe to find those works of art and return them to their countries of origins. Why am I mentioning that now? I'm mentioning it because the Nazis took what they took by their understanding of their right to do so through their superiority and their strength. America's commitment to return those works of art to the countries, and in some cases even continuing today, to the people from whom they had been stolen, reflect some of our noblest aspirations and our most honorable recognition of the principle of cultural property belonging to its country of origin, and that it is not the right of the richer or the more powerful to take it. So I just want to toss that out there as a recognition of the very highest aspirations of international justice, and the fact that those aspirations can be implemented when there is a strong political will and national ethical consensus to do so. Now, one important distinction that we really need to be clear on has to do with a niggling grammatical point, which of course we at the University of Chicago love niggling grammatical points. And that is, one can pose the question, who owns antiquity? But the real question is, who owns antiquities in the plural? Antiquity means the past. It's our shared human past. And to pose the question, who owns antiquity? Well, the answer is obvious. We all do. It is our shared cultural heritage. And that pharaonic Egyptian may have handed it off to the white guy from Chicago on the tympanum of the Oriental Institute in the slide that you saw earlier. But in fact, the handoff is to all of us. All of us are the descendants of that shared cultural inheritance. So antiquity in the singular belongs to all of us. Antiquities are objects. They're objects that help us understand the past. We're proud to have in our museum some of the finest antiquities that illustrate and elucidate the development of civilizations in the ancient Near East. But antiquities belong to their countries of origin. That's a very important point, and this is the point that the U.S. recognized at the end of World War II. It's the point that UNESCO recognizes. It's the point that's recognized by laws against trafficking in antiquities, laws against looting archaeological sites and smuggling them out. The UNESCO Convention of 1970 says that museums cannot accept objects that came into the country after 1970 unless they can be proven to have been legally exported from their countries of origin. That's not a perfect thing, but it's a baseline. It gives us a place to start. We live in a very imperfect world, and this is a very strong, very good beginning, and it's one to which the Oriental Institute is very proud to subscribe. So, on the one hand, then, we need to respect national sovereignty within a framework of international law. We need to have strong laws against both looting at the supply side and the importation of antiquities at the demand side. And of course, this is a principle that we recognize in other legal domains, such as international drug trafficking, where we are very, very serious about interdicting drugs. And it doesn't matter whether it's legal to export cocaine from Colombia, it's illegal to import it to the United States. Now, sovereignty does not, if you want to be blunt about it, I think this is a point where my colleague Jim Cuno and I would disagree, is I would argue that sovereignty does not really concern as much the question of whether there's a genetic or direct cultural link between the modern polity and the ancient civilization. Because modern states are the stewards of the ancient civilizations whose remains are in their midst. No one in their, no one would really contest the fact that the United States has a responsibility to care for the remains of Native American civilization, sites like Cahokia in Illinois, even though there may be some people here who are descendants of Native American groups in Illinois, but I think probably none of us here are. The odds are small. The point is, we are stewards of our past, and we have a responsibility to take care of it. So I would say then that we have to respect those laws both at a national level and at an international level. Now, I was earlier alluding to the idea that there can't be one law for the strong and one for the weak. The argument, Breasted was making this argument, well, these guys can't really take care of the artifacts from their past, and therefore we can do a better job, so we should have these materials. Well, it's a fact that the British colonial authorities, against whom Breasted had his objections, the British were very concerned with setting up a national museum, an antiquities service, antiquities laws. Their concern was to build up national institutions. And they may have been colonialists, they were, but the principle was a very good one. They did that in all the countries where they established their colonial rule. India is another very good example. They built up national institutions. And I would argue that's one of the most important things that we can do. I agree completely with Jim Cuno in the value of the Encyclopedic Museum. It opens people's eyes. It educates us to the diversity of cultures. It educates us to the shared heritage that all of us have. There is incredible, irreplaceable value to encyclopedic museums. My argument would be we should be building up encyclopedic museums everywhere. We should be building up departments of antiquities, local expertise in cultural heritage preservation, strong antiquities laws, strong university systems, and a strong museum infrastructure in the countries of the Middle East, South Asia, East Asia, and Africa. I would foresee a future where encyclopedic museums in countries around the world are exchanging exhibits rather than claiming that only Western countries have the right, not right, but by virtue of prior existence, that Western countries and their encyclopedic museums are somehow the only venue through which we can exhibit the treasures of other cultures and educate our publics. So I would argue then that the future should be building the framework of strong international law. I think we should respect existing laws. For example, the partage system, which existed in the 30s, the objects in our museum, most of them were exported legally by the laws of that time, and I believe we should continue to respect those laws. However, we should respect the sovereignty. That implicit in that is a respect for the sovereignty of the host country, and we should continue to exercise that respect. We need to work in a new partnership with countries around the world. My own excavations in Syria, we don't take out any artifacts at all from those countries. We work in partnership with Syria, with Egypt, with Israel, Turkey, with all the countries where we excavate. We work in partnership with them. We provide our expertise, we share in the knowledge, the artifacts remain in the countries of origin, and that's legitimate, and that is as it should be. So I would argue for a new partnership in research, in the development and strengthening of museums, and in the development and strengthening of legal structures to protect the cultural heritage of the countries around the world while promoting free exchanges of artifacts from museum to museum within a framework that respects the national sovereignty of those countries. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. You know, today's topic is a very super serious thing to talk about, and it hits me very personal. But before we do that, we should have some fun. So let's have some fun. I am director of an arts museum. I have no artistic talent. Can't sing, can't dance, write somewhat, but that's about it. Okay? Now, we've all seen the Indiana Jones movie, right? Films, okay? So let's have some fun with this. But please bear with me, because I tell you, I can't even hum, okay? Dun 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 dun. I'm just trying to set the mood here, okay? Do you all remember the scene in which Indy grabs that ancient piece and starts to run out the cave? Dun 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 dun. And arrows and huge spears, are shooting at him. And he's there, he's running like crazy. Dun 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 dun. And let's be honest, how many men in here, when they saw that movie, did not fantasize, no matter what kind of shape them, like me, I could lose a few, lose a few pounds, and we're thinking, I could do that. And how many of you, women here, be honest, are thinking, go, baby, run, Indy, run. Don't let them catch you. And then the boulder starts rolling down the cave towards Indy, and everyone is saying, run, Indy, run. And of course he escapes. But how many of us stop to think that we're cheering a thief? An unemployed person steals from a 7-Eleven, and he gets sent to jail. A college professor, he rips off someone's culture, he's a hero. Strange world we're in, baby, strange world. Let's change the scenario. Let's pretend I'm in a film called Mexicano Jones, okay? Now, I can't hum, Santana music either, I'm sorry. So, we'll get back to the original soundtrack, okay? Dun-dun-dun-dun, dun-dun-dun. And I'm in the Smithsonian Museums. And I'm running through all these museums and all, the cultural places in Washington. I'm stealing the Declaration of Independence, the Gettysburg Address, the U.S. Constitution, dun-dun-dun-dun, dun-dun-dun. Okay, where's the cheers for me? Who wants to be with me? So it all depends who's doing the stealing, isn't it? Stealing is the operative word. There's no PC way about saying this. There isn't. There's no nice way. What's going on in Arizona today is racism. There's no way to say it. That's what it is. Let's deal with it. Let's try to, do away with it. Some people in the United States, and a great majority of museums directors, can't relate to how important culture is to identity. Oh, and I'm going to, and I'm going to have a lot of trouble with Mr. Cuno, because I'm going to get very emotional. And Mr. Cuno's books doesn't like the word emotion, it seems like. But in his books, he always refers to pieces as objects, or the term today, cultural property. My house is property. This is property. Culture isn't property. It's patrimony. You don't own it. Even the name of today's thing, who owns the past? Nobody owns the past, okay? We all do, not one person. It's kind of crazy the terms we use to talk about this. And when I think of the word of objects, it's almost like it's like a frog that needs to be dissected, and there's no real acknowledgement of how important these pieces are to identity of people. I'm Mexican. I am very proud to be Mexicano. I can't tell you how important it is to me, how important identity is. And that's in the United States that I really don't see. And it's a sad thing to not have that in many people. It's just so rich to have this in your history. Ancient pieces of my culture are not objects. They are almost sacred to me. They're almost, spiritual to me. When I'm in the National Museum of Anthropology in Mexico, in the, Mexica Hall, which is the one the Aztecs have, with the Aztec calendar and all those pieces. Even right now, I'm kind of like, goosebumpery. I mean, it's incredible. Or to be in, Palenque or Teotihuacan, and just to walk around that. I mean, it's just, that's my holy land. I mean, it's magic to be around these pieces. And it's about who I am as a person. And the United States is very different from that country in the world. We have an ancient history. But it isn't about who we think it is, because our ancient history involves what happened before the white man came to this part of the world. So when we describe ancient U.S. history, it would actually probably start, with the founding of Jamestown. Consequently, as a very young nation, we don't have that many pieces that are culturally as significantly to the average person in the United States. So I began thinking, how can I compare any change of policy that result in the stealing, ripping off of ancient pieces by large art museums in this country. So I had to come up with this scenario. Once again, you have to bear with me. Let's pretend we all did a Rip Van Winkle. And for some unknown reason, every night stage went to sleep for 20 to 30 years, okay? When we wake up, we find out the Statue of Liberty is gone. It's actually in Greece. You remember Greece. They still want the Elgin marbles to be returned. What happened is, while we were all asleep, a group of Greek scholars came to the United States during the time we were asleep and noticed that there were serious flaws in the statue. Remember about the renovation of about Statue of Liberty like 20, 30 years ago? Well, let's say for the sake of argument that these scholars discovered that the materials used for the renovation were so deficient that they didn't fix the problem quickly that the whole sculpture would just, crumble and fall apart. And the only way they could fix it would be to use materials found only in Greece. So they took Statue of Liberty back to Greece. And now, we're all awake now, 25, 30 years later, we're awake. And we want the statue back. And the Greeks argue, well, you didn't take care of the piece properly. We took much better care of the piece than you did. And then the Greeks argue, you know, you people in the United States, you know, you have these emotions getting in your way, you don't know? The statue should stay in Greece. Now, I would bet anything that if this really happened and, you know, U.S. president at the time would send Marines in to bring back Statue of Liberty, that would be such an enormously super popular act in this country. We all have things that are important to who we are, and they belong to us, you know, and they belong to, you know, as you know, I said, as, you know, as a Mexican, I can't tell you how what these pieces mean to me. You know, I mean, and to see what people have done in the past with chainsaws have gone to sites and ripped pieces and 2, 3, 4 pieces to sell, and they find a way in museums. Unbelievable. And then museums, which is funny, many museums in this country have pieces that they acquired, and they know the pieces here in the wrong way, against the law. And you know, how can that be? You know, why aren't they in jail for doing this? And they know it. They know these pieces here illegally. So the thing about laws, to me, I worry about laws. We have laws that are being enforced. You know, any museum director who acquires a piece that they suspect is here illegally, you know, he should go to jail. I'm sorry. He's breaking the law. You know, there is a big difference there's a big difference between white collar crime and blue collar crime almost. And you know something else? I want to say this. I love museums. I love museums so much that, you know, years ago I said, you know, I make my own museum. But museums aren't infallible. I once wrote that one of the reasons for the lack of diversity at all levels in the museum field is racism. You should have seen the reaction. How can I dare say that these things about museums? It's almost like museums can do no wrong. Well, yes, they can. Nobody's perfect, folks. We cannot forget that many leading museums in this country, and you know, we have to be clear about this, stole artwork from families of individuals who perished in the Holocaust. Whenever a museum receives a donation in their collection, you should always ask, how did you acquire the piece? That's the first thing you ask. So here we are, right after the most disastrous war in human history, with the murder of millions of innocent victims. And here are museums acquiring pieces. And so when I use the term greed, I'm not exaggerating. This kind of misguided policy to change things around so mainstream museums in the United States can reacquire pieces is very, very scary to me. And you have to ask your question, how much is enough for these large encyclopedic museums? Our current financial crisis was caused primarily by greed. Their institute is a magnificent museum. It's an amazing, amazing, amazing museum. If it acquired another piece for the next 1,000 years, it would still be a magnificent museum. So if one of the motivating factors behind Mr. Cuno's suggested policies is to serve the broad public, you already have all these pieces to serve the bad public. Okay, to serve the broad public. I can tell you several ways that encyclopedic museums can better serve the public, and it doesn't involve having to steal somebody's culture. Museums are filled with warehouses and storage areas. I tell you this stuff gets me going, with thousands of wonderful ancient pieces, many of which never get to see the light of day and probably never will. Why not start a long-range program with these pieces? Why not send these pieces to museums in Rockford, Peoria, and Springfield, and give people a chance to see these pieces? The Institute just opened a beautiful modern wing. It's gorgeous. It's fantastic. And that's the direction that all encyclopedia museums should focus on. So I'm not trying to tell you how to do your job as a Cuno, than all art museum directors out there. But better yet, why not start showcasing the local artists? Wouldn't it be great to showcase the wonderful Chicago artists, both established and emerging, at these large art museums on a permanent basis? That would be a great way and a very cost-efficient way to serve the greater public. I proposed a plan in the Museum News Journal several years ago that I believe creates a win-win situation for most people in this situation. Every country should be allowed to pick 5 pieces that they want returned from any museum in the world. No museum, however, would have more than 10 pieces repatriated. In return for this, all of the museums would in turn get long-term loans of similar pieces from the countries whose pieces are being returned. Then one gets a George Soros, a Bill Gates, to pay for an exhibition like this, where you gather all of these pieces together. And just imagine how great an exhibition this would be. And it travels all around the world, not just the United States or Europe, all around the world. And everyone will have a chance to see these pieces before they return home. H-O-M-E, before they return home. The only one who probably complained would be the large museums and the misguided beliefs that they own these pieces. However, they would still have great pieces on display. And do I believe that anybody in this room would care if the pieces on loan for 500 years, 100 years, or 20 years, or 2 years, whatever, or the museum owns it as long as you have a chance to see it, for God's sake? You know, the one word that keeps popping up in me in this whole discussion is the word own. No museum owns the past. My institution has 6,500 pieces of artwork in our collection. We don't own them. We are caretakers. It's a kind of a trust situation. I don't own my kids, okay? I own my house, not my kids. And the same kind of principle should apply here. Instead of large museums being proud of how they serve the public, or how good their programs are in trying to serve young kids, or diversity, it is this drive, this compulsion, this need to own more that moves them. It's not about the public good, no way. And you know what? Everybody has this fallacy. I'll tell you a story of me when I was a kid. I love baseball cards. Still do, I have a baseball card collection. And as a kid, I must confess, I had a fist fight with my best friend over a Frank Robinson post-cereal baseball card. Okay, remember those cards that came in the back of cereal boxes and you would cut them out? We both sincerely believed the card was ours. So imagine, I'm fighting with my best friend over a card that, quite honestly, we both already had the card in our collection 2, 3, 4, 5 times over. But unfortunately, we want the 6th card, the 7th, the 8th. I was being bad, greedy, pure, and simple. This policy that's being discussed, I don't know how we're discussing this. It's like, there should be no discussion about this. But it's scary times. It's very, very scary, scary times. But I want to say that, you know, that when I hear the argument that we can take care of things better, that's the same policy. In fact, you don't believe me? Just, you know, Google George Bush in Iraq. It's the same policy George Bush uses in Iraq, that we're going to take care of you, and we know better, and we have the means, and you don't know what you're doing. It's the same sick policy that is heads in Iraq now, years later, causes us billions and billions of dollars. You know, lives have been killed. It's the same mindset that somehow God's in heaven with the flag of America on his shoulder, and we're better than the whole world. We're not, okay? No one has been anybody else. Thank you.
Formerly the moderator of this, but based on the panelists' presentations, I suspect they'll have plenty to talk about among themselves without me getting in the way too much. But I wanted maybe just to get the ball rolling by maybe highlighting a possible area of agreement among the three presentations, which seemed to me to be the idea that greater exchange of objects, art, antiquities could proceed from the idea that nobody owns this material; we're all stewards of it. And you all touched on that in one way or another in your talks. And I don't know if Jim, would you like to address this? I mean, you mentioned the possibility that long-term loans was sort of a way, rather than an antiquities market, to achieve a wider circulation of these materials.
Yeah, I mean, I think ownership is just an instrument of stewardship. It is how one is given responsibility for the preservation of something. And it is the case that objects are owned, literally owned. I mean, within the framework of the legal system, nationally and internationally, they are property. They're called cultural property by the nations who have cultural property laws governing these things. So they are owned in that respect. But as Gil said, it's really a means of stewardship. It's acknowledging a responsibility for the preservation of that thing and providing broader access to it by some means of sharing. It has been the case, however, as Geoff outlined earlier, that laws have changed over the course of the 20th century with the rise of nationalism over the course of the first half of the 20th century, and governments have instituted cultural property laws that have been retentive, retentionist, that is to retain within the jurisdiction of that nation state all such things, such that the legal regime through which and within which the Oriental Institute was able to build these very important scholarly collections here for the sake of scholarship and education is no longer in place, and the Oriental Institute, if it were founded today, would not exist, could not exist as a collection at least of objects, let alone all the scholarship that goes independent of that. So I think my criticism is with these retentionist laws, because literally, Carlos spoke about museums being engorged, their storerooms engorged with objects. The engorged storerooms really exist in Cairo and in throughout Italy, where these things are retained by law within the jurisdiction of the nation states. And I think there needs to be a way to encourage museums to share. I would disagree with Gil that somehow Western art museums are claiming, I've never heard this ever said anywhere, that only in the West should there be encyclopedic museums, because we have only in the West is there a right to have them. I agree and made the argument in my book that encyclopedic museums are a good thing, and I guess I disagree with Carlos and think they are a good thing, that they ought to be everywhere in the world, but one has to cultivate a desire for encyclopedic museums, for that curiosity about the world everywhere in the world. Understandably, the development of politics over time, with the rise of nationalism in the middle of this 20th century, it was clearly the case that one wanted to be curious about one's own state, the formation of a state and an identity of a state, so one was inward looking. Now we need to find a way to encourage that curiosity about the world that is defined in the West, in any case, by the Enlightenment interest in the world. And it's not equally evident everywhere in the West, but I agree that access is really the goal in this instance. Ownership is just a means of stewardship within the framework of international law.
The stuff that the West is enlightened, the rest of the world isn't. I would say over half the people in the United States could not find 10 countries on a map. I mean, I would argue that over half the young men in Afghanistan and Iraq don't even know those places are, what the history is. Now, okay, for folks like you, okay, people in this room, for the mass majority of people in this country, they are not enlightened about the world. So that isn't true. I would argue the opposite. I would, you know, having spent, you know, long periods of time down in Mexico, they are interested in everything globally. They really are. And they know us much better than we know them. So stuff that they're not enlightened.
Carlos, you misheard me.
No, I didn't mishear you.
I said enlightenment. That is an 18th century phenomenon in Europe, and that's the foundation for these principles about cosmopolitanism in the modern sense as you know them. And I didn't say that only in the West, by which you might have interpreted me to think the United States are over-curious about the world. Anywhere there's anyone curious about the world, that ought to be encouraged, it seems to me. I don't care where that happens to be.
As far as ownership and stewardship go, I think that we were slightly mishearing each other. I sort of changed my words in the middle. I did not mean to say that only the West has the right to have encyclopedic museums. I was arguing that we should be encouraging the development of encyclopedic museums across the globe. I wanted to point out, it didn't occur to me until hearing Carlos and Jim talking, that we're really talking about I had spoken of the need that national sovereignty means the stewardship of the cultural heritage within its borders. And I agree with Carlos in using the term cultural patrimony. That's usually when I have more than 10 minutes to pontificate, I'll say cultural patrimony. It's something that's very, very salient for us here at the Oriental Institute, where we are stewards of the Persepolis fortification tablets, which are priceless in terms of the cultural identity of the people of Iran. And our job has been to translate those tablets, and we would like to return them to Iran. In fact, I've made two trips to Iran, and one of them I brought back we brought a group of us, Laura D'Alessandro and Bill Harms from this university and myself, we each brought back 100 of these tablets that we had translated. We brought them back to Iran. It made it into the news, and we were promptly sued by a group that wanted to confiscate the tablets, sell them at auction satisfy a claim in a terrorism damage suit. So we are stewards of the past, and we are doing our best to protect these tablets that we recognize do not belong to us. They belong to the people of Iran. And those were the terms under which we were allowed to borrow those tablets back in the late 1930s. So stewardship is very important, and we distinguish between stewardship and ownership of ancient cultural patrimony. I want to point out that there are ways that the United States is actually very deficient in terms of our stewardship of the past and our legal frameworks. We like to think of ourselves as very, very progressive, but the fact is archaeological sites in the United States, if they're on private property, the owner of that private property can do whatever they please with the site and with the contents of the site. In most Middle Eastern countries, archaeological sites are defined as cultural patrimony and as the property of the state. And I can say as an archaeologist who's worked in New Mexico and Arizona, that I was deeply grateful to be working on the property of a rancher who had the vision and farsightedness to protect the ancient Pueblo site that was on his land, but he didn't have any legal obligation to do so. So we have to recognize that we are not always in the forefront of things, and that we have a lot to learn from other countries in terms of protecting cultural heritage, and that we do, well, the struggle is really to come up with the proper balance of ownership, stewardship, and a recognition of international law and the rights of other sovereign countries.
Well, thank you, all three. I guess I wanted to ask Carlos a question, because it seemed like you were developing two different themes in your presentation. One, that art is an icon of cultural identity, and that therefore, I guess, the implication is that artifacts should be held by the people whose ancestors produced them. And on the other hand, you're advocating a kind of exchange of these objects around the world in some form, in the form of a loan program or something like this. And so I'm wondering if you can address those two competing impulses.
No, they are competing. You know, why can't, you know, we have pieces borrowed that go all over the world, you know, continuously? That's a great policy. That's stuff that the museums in the United States need to acquire more and more, I understand. And there's a story I have to tell you. There's one collector went to his house about 2 years ago. He had a jade piece from Teotihuacan that was amazing. There's any museum in the world that's seen a piece that nice. And so the piece was jade. He put it in his, you know, kitchen, because his kitchen was green, and it's right next to, you know, a microwave. So imagine, here's this, like, almost a sacred object next to something to cook, what, Pop-Tarts or something. I mean, it's scary. I mean, you know, these pieces should belong to the people, you know, of those countries. They should be in those institutions. I'm not saying return everything back for Institute. I didn't say return everything from all these museums. I'm saying pick five objects every country gets to pick from around the world, and they are returned. Like the Elgin marbles, why those pieces are not returned? And just the name too, but Elgin marbles, the name of the person who stole them, basically, who took them. I know these, you know, these. I mean, it's crazy. Why not give those back to those countries? What is the great harm?
Yeah, I want us to think carefully about this association of objects with ethnicity and with a sense of a patrimony, because it what that does is essentialize a difference in the world. That this object, it has a characteristics akin to a human being, and that distinguishes that object and that relationship to that particular human being from all other objects and all the other relationships to human beings in the world as defining difference in the world. And what I would like us to think about is ways in which we recognize that these objects, in fact, bear traces of common identity, not distinct identity, and that ethnicity as enforced by the state, we have to think about what that means as well. And that is, the state has a particular agenda of power, and its identity with a certain ethnicity needs to conform with that. And I just quote from a book by Professor Chakrabarty here, Deepesh Chakrabarty here at the University of Chicago, who says that ethnicity can find a place in public life only so long as its expression is in conformity with the core values of the nation as defined by the state. So I want us just to think as you now and leave and forever after about this easy relationship that sometimes is made between ethnicity and objects, because I think that it can only reinforce difference rather than commonality.
What we're talking about is there is diversity. That is wonderful. Imagine if every flower was a rose instead of all the flowers in the world. Diversity is beautiful. That's what the celebration is. So I love all cultures of the world, but we are distinct. And if we all looked and talked the same, it'd be a boring planet, for God's sake. In terms of this whole thing about this nation state you keep talking about, let me tell you, I'm a very proud Mexican. The right in Mexico, the left, the center of those street parties, I don't trust at all. They do not define who I am, okay? Barack Obama, John McCain, do not define who I am, okay? So this is about this whole concept about the nation state is this intellectual mumble jumble that's not true, Jim. You know, I define who I am. It's not a country, a nation, not politicians. Trust me.
Let's get a word in.
Just one thing quickly. Okay, you might define who you are, but the nation state defines what cultural property is. And polices it.
I want to make I think it's an important distinction, and that is we're not so much concerned with ethnicity. In a sense, ethnicity is one of the most charged terms there is, but I would argue we should be phrasing our discussion in terms of culture, that what we're talking about is that these objects of cultural patrimony are important because of the cultural context in which they exist. And I think that may be a really good bridging, a way to bridge between the position that Jim and that Carlos have set forth here, that there is absolutely a place and a reason for nations to exercise sovereignty. We sure as hell want to exercise our own sovereignty over our own country, and that has to logically imply that we have to respect the rights of other countries to exercise sovereignty over their own nations. Now, are there limits to it? Absolutely. Are there distinctions between a nation state's political policies and the degree to which it values and treasures its cultural patrimony? Absolutely. And I want to give you two examples. When the Iranian Revolution took place, in the first throes of the revolution, there's a concept in Islam, jahiliyyah, which means the period of ignorance, and it refers to the period before Islam. Now, most Islamic countries recognize that while there is this cultural concept of jahiliyyah, that doesn't mean that they hate their own past from before the spread of Islam to their country. But for this brief, terrible moment in Iranian history, the governor of Shiraz province wanted to bulldoze Persepolis. And fortunately, everyone else in Shiraz, in Fars province, said, "Oh no, you're not." And the fact is that there is a tension between religion and between culture. And we see this playing out again and again throughout the world. The essence of the battle for Afghanistan in the time of the Soviet invasion was the Russians wanted to emphasize the national ethnic divisions as a way of ruling Afghanistan, whereas the resistance to the Russians emphasized Islam as a unifying factor. So there's a constant tension between politics, culture, and ethnicity. But the objects of cultural patrimony, the beauty of those objects within their cultural context, is they have a very powerful unifying force. And they are that unifying force that transcends politics in almost every single case, even to the point that when the Germans were told to burn Paris, even the Germans, occupiers of Paris, recognized, well, maybe that's not such a good idea to do. So, in fact, we have to consider these items of cultural patrimony within their cultural context. To consider them within their cultural context doesn't mean you're ghettoizing them. it doesn't mean you're appropriating them so they don't belong to anyone else. I think Jim has given a wonderful example. I think in one of your books you talked about the production of these amazing Attic black and red figure vases that were produced in Greece, were traded all over the Eastern Mediterranean. A lot of them ended up in Italy, in Etruria, and then from there, some of them got looted and ended up at the Met, like the Euphronios crater would be an example. Well, is it Greek? Is it Etrurian? Is it Italian? Is it American? The fact is, it exists within a broad cultural context, and it is a treasure that links all of those contexts. But where does it belong? It belongs in the country where it was found, because the very richness of that Eastern Mediterranean trade, that the cosmopolitan global culture of what was called Magna Graecia, that world of the Greek colonies and the countries with which they interacted, that's as much a part of world culture as anything else. So I would say, let's not talk about ethnicity, let's focus on culture and cultural context and sovereignty as an overarching framework whose job it is to protect cultural patrimony and its cultural context.
I think you can make a case that an object, if by belong you mean someone has primary stewardship responsibility by virtue of the fact that it was found within the political jurisdiction of the state, I agree with that sense of belonging. Belonging, if you mean that it needs to be there to have value, I think that I would argue that. I would think that it actually belongs to everyone. It needs to be elsewhere, not just in that place. It needs to be shared with the world in some greater sense, not just kept within that one location. One last thing, and that is, I do think, and I know that you were saying this as well, because if Persepolis were at risk, I'm sure that you would want to oppose the actions of the state, that is to speak out, not like personal intervention, but to speak out against those actions.
I'd stand in front of the bulldozers.
And I think that we have to absolutely do that. This idea that we have no right to argue with actions or statements of another nation state, I think is dead wrong. After all, the Taliban had every right to destroy the Bamiyan Buddhas, absolutely every right. They had the authority in that jurisdiction, and we had to oppose it. So I think that we ought to oppose nation states, our own and others, if we feel that they're breaking, by their actions, principles that we value.
Well, I would agree with that, and that's why one of the first things I talked about was the idea of the term that I was calling a collective sense of ethics, and that's what really has to come into play. We face this problem all the time, the fact of the genocide in Darfur, and I will call it genocide. Is that it's occurring within the boundaries of a country, but it's state-sanctioned murder. Well, the fact is there is a collective sense of ethics that we recognize some things are wrong. And what I'm saying is our collective sense of ethics evolves over time. Things that were considered perfectly acceptable 300 years ago, we no longer consider perfectly acceptable. The slave trade is a great example of something where a country like, the United States could say, well, you know, we call it a peculiar institution, but that means we hold slaves. Well, thank goodness for, you know, countries like England and the Royal Navy, where they said, we're going to ban the international trade in slaves, and they shut it down. And then over time, every country in the world came to agree and subscribe to a new collective sense of ethics. And what I'm arguing for is that we need to develop a collective sense of ethics that respects cultural patrimony. I completely agree that I don't think there's an inherent moral right that an object that was created in one culture, in one country, can only stay there. But we do have to recognize, and UNESCO, we recognize there are items of cultural patrimony that are very, very special. Carlos was mentioning Statue of Liberty, the Declaration of Independence. We do recognize some things as very, very special. And we have to have some kind of protective principles. We have to have a collective sense of ethics that is codified into international law to protect those items, to respect the rights of individual countries to define what of the items within their borders fall within those categories. And we want people to respect it for us, and we have to respect it for other countries.
But Jim, one extra question. What's wrong with just traveling shows of these great pieces all over the world? Why do you have to own more pieces?
Once again, the ownership is stewardship, and so I don't want you to think that ownership is hoarding things and claiming it to be ours and no one else's. But it's also the case that the value in this great institution is having things here for multiple generations to experience. Right now, under the current regimes, loans from other that are from nations that have the ownership of those things, whether it be Italy or Mexico, is on a very short-term duration. It's in the case of Italy, it was less than a year, and now it's been extended in certain situations to 4 years. So I'm all for these loans of things. I want them to be long-term, because I don't want it to be just the case that if we had 3 months to see it. I want it to be the case that our children and our grandchildren have a chance to see it, or, you know, exchanges over the course of 25 years. Right now, that is impossible. But if it were possible, I would agree with you.
Okay. My name is Mark Jaffe. I would like each of the panelists to amplify their position on looting and to react to a specific proposal to reduce looting that was made in a popular magazine about a year and a half ago. I think we would all agree that looting reduces the possibility for people to understand the past as well as future generations. And on the other hand, our present set of institutions, there seems to be a proliferation of looting, and more objects get into somebody's green kitchen. How do the proposals reduce looting instead of encourage it? And then this specific idea was that archaeological expeditions should be financed by the sale of objects and sent to places that are common targets for looters. Thank you.
Okay, any one of you?
I would say that using the proceeds from the sale of looted objects as a way to finance archaeological exhibits is kind of like using the money from heroin sales to finance methadone clinics.
Sell the objects they find. I think that's the point, that archaeologists would sell extra artifacts. Yeah. Is that the proposal?
Well, I think it's got to be that if that proposal was in the press, I didn't see the article, that has to be on the lines of, Jonathan Swift's modest proposal of the way to get rid of the problem of poverty was to eat poor people, I think, wasn't that? It's ridiculous. No, that's not, archaeology is not about recovering objects. Archaeology is about understanding our heritage of civilization. It's not about the stuff. It's about the knowledge that we can put together from the stuff. That stuff is extraordinarily important as the evidentiary basis. So, looting. I think we all agree looting is a terrible thing. Epidemics of looting take place when there is a breakdown of civil order, civil society, and the rule of law. So to say that there is looting and looting is going to go on anyway, well, that's not an argument for saying it should be okay to import looted objects. The way to stop looting, there are two ways to do it. One is at the source to help build strong civil institutions, the rule of law, and security and civil society in the host countries. Civil society meaning not having corrupt officials who turn another eye to looting. At the consuming end, in the middle, we have to have strong international laws against international trafficking in looted objects, and at the consuming end, we have to have strong laws against the importation of those objects. The United States has started doing that, but it's only in bilateral treaties. That means we have to have a treaty with specifically Italy to say that anything from Italy, we won't take it in. We need to broaden that principle. So I would say that would be my answer for how to deal with looting.
I would agree with Gil in every respect with the last point. That is, it's not that what the legal regime is not only limited to those nations with which, you know, have a bilateral relationship between the two of them. That is, that there are cultural property laws, ownership and export laws. And any time, and I want to disabuse anyone in the audience who thinks that museums in the West, looking at the audience representing them here, willfully, knowingly, carelessly acquires objects that may have been looted. That's a canard that must be shelved. The means by which we investigate, by through due diligence efforts with our lawyers, whether we can have clear title for an object is extensive, because it's not about only looting, it's about illegal export, or it's about a state that claims ownership and now you have it. How did it come out from where it might have come? And if we don't have clear evidence, because two things are at stake, reputation is at stake, money's at stake. If we don't have clear evidence that we can acquire and hold clear title, we do not acquire that object. And we've turned down many, many more things than we have acquired over the course of the last 5 years, 6 years that I've been director. Now, it is the case that since the 1960s, the 1960s, 1990s, the sort of extent to which one did due diligence and the extent to which the United States implemented or accepted export laws from other nations as ownership laws has changed dramatically. So the Euphonious Crater, which was acquired, I think, in 1970 by Thomas Hoving, not by Philippe de Montebello, who then returned it, that object over the course of time was investigated. It wasn't until that warehouse was broken into and records were found and that evidence was such that the Metropolitan Museum understood that there was beyond something of a doubt, would you say in legal terms, beyond reasonable doubt that this thing had been improperly removed and at least so it returned it. The law governs these relationships, and every object that we acquire, modern or ancient, we have to be absolutely confident that we can hold clear title, because the law states that.
Okay, I have a question to you, Jim. Okay, are you saying that no museum in the United States has pieces in their collection since the passage of the UNESCO law in 82 United States, they have not acquired pieces that they have doubts about? Yes or no? No museum in this country.
You know, I can tell you, we don't.
No, we. You know, okay. This is not about attitude. We're talking about the broad, about the world.
Carlos,
is there any museum, do you think, in this country that has pieces that they acquired illegally? Yes or no? Just answer the question. Talk about attitude. Any museum,
I can't answer
museum.
The question.
No, you don't want to answer that question. It's true.
You can tell me what you think I'm thinking, but I can tell you.
No, you don't want to answer that question, because then your argument goes out the window. You know they've acquired pieces, and they still do.
Carlos, I don't know that. I simply don't know that. And I don't know that you know that.
If your life depended on it, I bet you would answer yes.
I think there's a little more. Yeah,
don't be a lawyer now, Jim. Just answer the things directly.
Oh, I'm Larry Rowe.
Okay.
Wait.
There's another question, too. And if they did do this, should they be in jail? Should they go to jail, Jim?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, good.
That's very obvious. You break a law, you go to jail.
That's good. That's good to hear.
I'm Larry Rothfield. I'm glad we're on to the topic of looting, because I think that the question of nationalism is a kind of a side issue. What's changed over the last 50 years has been the development of a global market in illicit antiquities, and the market is going to be there whether or not the American museums stop collecting materials that are on provenance, as they've mostly agreed to do. So the real question is, how do we strengthen the laws? What do we do to strengthen laws? We live in the United States where the state of Arizona has just closed 5 state parks that were subject to major looting before they were policed and are now again open to looters to loot, because they don't have the money to do that. So it seems to me the real issue is, how do we get the money to help both ourselves and other countries to strengthen their policing and their protection of the archaeological sites that are under their stewardship? One suggestion might be to tax the sale of antiquities domestically and then use those proceeds to help pay for protective efforts both in the United States and outside. But I'd be interested in what the panel thinks are actual practical solutions to getting the resources to the people who are charged with actually protecting these valuable artifacts.
I mean, I think, you know, we've talked about this before, and I think that I'm a little uncomfortable, somewhat like Gil was, although initially when you said that, I expressed interest in the idea, but I'm a little uncomfortable in using the market as the mechanism of this, and for one reason, because it just encourages the acquisition of antiquities, even those that are undocumented activities that are not acquired by museums but are acquired openly by private individuals. And most, as we said when we talked about this before, most of this activity isn't occurring in this country in any case. You know, most of this activity is occurring elsewhere in the world, so policing it will be difficult. I think that if the world values this, the world has to find a way to fund it. And just as the world values a certain stability in the world, and I'm not an expert to praise or condemn the International Monetary Fund, probably you guys can, and for both praise and condemn it, but there are instruments out there, whether it's a private foundation of enormous wealth, like the Bill Gates Foundation, whether it's the United Nations, whether it's the European Union, I mean, there's all kinds of stuff. It seems to me that's where collectively, you know, we need to come together as governments, because that's the means by which this money gets distributed, or extraordinarily wealthy private foundations.
I should point out that Larry Rothfield is the former head of the Cultural Policy Center here at the University of Chicago, and has worked very extensively and intensively on these kinds of issues, and has written intensively on them, and he has a number of books on the subject. I'm very hesitant to even address this, but it seems to me that, at the risk of being corny, that getting back to this idea of a collective sense of ethics, that has to really be at the heart of it, because when there's a collective sense of ethics, it means that we can take action on an internationally recognized problem where we all recognize it's a problem, and we can take action on it at several different levels. I was very much in agreement with Jim bringing into play the idea of the United Nations. We have structures like UNESCO, and we have structures like the International Monetary Fund or the World Bank. There are international structures that can help with these kinds of efforts in terms of, some people may consider it a dirty word, but nation building is really, or state building, is a very important concept. And building civil society is very essential in this case. What do I mean when I say that? It means we have to teach or encourage countries to educate their people about the value of their history. It means we have to help them develop strong antiquities laws. It means we have to help with expertise, with loans, with money, to help them develop the instruments, the legal and the organizational instruments to police themselves. And surprisingly, a lot of this can be done really cheaply. My colleague Matt Gibson did some back-of-the-envelope arithmetic after the invasion of Iraq, and he figured that for about, I forgot if it was $1 or $3 million, we could basically have worked out financial agreements with every tribal sheikh across Iraq to basically hire their own tribesmen to take care of the archaeological sites in their boundaries. So what would that be doing? It would be, well, yes, a stimulus package of a sort, but it would pacify the countryside, it would protect the archaeological record, and it would provide employment to people, not for a lot of money. And I'm pointing this out because Laura Bush, was it 2 years ago, announced a $13 million aid package for Iraqi cultural heritage. For some tiny, well, not tiny, but a fraction of that, we could have been setting up institutions to protect, at the local level, to protect the antiquities of Iraq. Well, I'm going to add one last thing and then shut up, and that is that we, the Oriental Institute, the University of Chicago, and I don't know enough about what other museums like the Art Institute or the National Museum of Mexican Cultural Heritage are doing, but I think we should be developing partnerships with individual museums in other countries and working with them to help with our own expertise to help them with protecting cultural heritage. We can provide advisory expertise on the development of antiquities laws as well. So what I'm arguing for is you could call it a multi-scale approach to this at the international level of the UNESCO and the World Bank, at the national level of laws, and then at the level of in private institutions and even private individuals. Like, you know, it would be great if the Gates Foundation or the Soros Foundation were interested in doing it to help provide the funds to give this kind of enforcement. It has to be attacked at multiple levels.
Okay, thank you. Next question.
I have a question that wasn't exactly considered, and you may not even want to consider it if your background's. I'm thinking about non-intrinsic objects, such as dinosaur bones, human bones, organic material like feathers and stone and other birds or animals, and things like pottery and other types of stone lithic tools, for instance. What do you think that has? I don't think that you could attach that to any either patrimony, ethnicity, or culture, and I don't see how you would return it to any particular place since there weren't any countries often at that point. I don't know if you want to consider this. And the other thing that you haven't really talked about, and that is any attitude that has not to do with the West. In other words, I'm thinking about, for instance, China or India in particular. In China, there was tomb looting from the Shang Dynasty all the way up to Mao Zedong when they had Cultural Revolution and they destroyed things. I don't know if you want to consider any of those.
The first part of the question, which had to do with, I guess we call them non-art objects, natural materials or human remains. We have in this country a law regarding museums' responsibility toward human remains, and that is that they should be returned to, and so it has to do with Native Americans, called Native American Graves Protection Act. And so they must be inventoried, they must be examined, they must be, if it can be proven that they are actually of the people who are claiming them, they must be returned to the people. And in some cases, that can be proven, I gather. In other cases, it's very, very complicated. And it's a profoundly difficult matter, it seems to me, in some ways so much greater in interest and profundity than the other objects we've been talking about, the other matters we've been talking about, because there, sometimes science and belief simply come into conflict and you can't resolve the conflict. We saw that with the Kennewick man, in which people were claiming it, scientists said there was no grounds for that claim. So it's a very, very interesting problem, and it's just has to be negotiated in every relationship, every instance, I think.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I'm Geoff Melsey. I've got three points I want to make, so I hope you'll bear with me. The first, I like your concept of accessibility, you know, making things accessible, and, you know, I'm glad to hear that the universities and museums have trimmed back on acquiring new items, and I call upon them to make the collections that they have available accessible. You had mentioned that a lot of stuff is in storage. There is a way to do it now, okay? You know, photographic technology is really advanced. The web is advanced. So I call upon you to pull the stuff out that you already have, photograph it, make it accessible for free on the web, not just via a $40 book or gift shop. So that's the first concept. The second, related to accessibility, the flip side of accessibility means that there is a need to have these things accessible. That means that there needs to be a willing audience that wants to view them. So, and how do we address that? So. The third concept I'd like to bring up is the concept of coins. As you know, Italy is putting pressure on the U.S. to limit import of coins that have passed through Italy. So if Italy wants all their Roman coins back, you know, I understand that they would like to have them back, but I haven't heard a lot about what they intend to do with them. So where do you stand on Italy putting pressure on the U.S. to restrict imports?
Can I just, I'm just going to answer your first one and then turn it over to other colleagues. The question of accessibility, I'm glad you asked that question, because at the Oriental Institute, one of the things that we've started is something that we call our integrated database. And we just got a very large capital budget allocation from the university to implement it. We want to do exactly what you're saying. We have somewhere between, Geoff corrected me. I thought it was 200,000, but I guess it's closer to 300,000 objects in our museum. Our goal is to have good digital records of all of them and put them on the web so that they are visible and accessible to everyone. And that's a very strong commitment that we have. And not just the pictures of them, but very detailed archaeological and curatorial information about them. This is a trend that is going on in all the museums in the world to greater or lesser extent. We're at the very beginning of it, but it's absolutely happening. I completely agree with you. This is the single best way to democratize access to those objects, because most people just want to see it. Then there'll be a group of researchers who want to see it in a little more detail, and then there'll be a tiny group of people who are maybe doing a dissertation or writing a book who really physically need to examine the object, but they're in the minority. Now, different museums will have different kinds of objects, but I think that is the general trend. The British Museum is, they're way ahead of us on this, but we are going that track. So in answer to your first question, I agree, and we are doing, we're in the middle of doing something about it.
Gil, I have a question.
I think that also addresses the second question about the accessibility. So I agree with you, you know, that there is a need to catalog everything so that it is accessible to those who want it, you know, but there will be a very limited audience, you know, who's going to go in, you know, and study these things.
So Gil, I have a question. So how many pieces are in your collection?
Well, when I say we have somewhere between 200,000 and 300,000 pieces, some of them are...
So there are storages. And lots of artwork out there, right? You said there isn't.
I know there is. I was trying to say, yes.
But there's good stuff you got, right? Oh, that's not being shown. A lot of good stuff, right?
I think it's pretty good.
Yeah, I know
but
it's
But I want
good.
To make the distinction between, when I say between 200 and 300,000 objects, that's everything from single beads and flint tools to winged bulls.
No, but my point is, but there is a lot of great stuff in your collection, right? That's not on display right now.
Oh, yeah. I think every museum has a huge ratio of what's in storage to what's on display.
So why do we need more ownership of pieces? Get back to that statement.
I wasn't arguing with you. We don't acquire more
stuff. There aren't all these storages. There's a lot of pieces in storage in this country.
I would echo Gil, just that I would say numerically, I don't know, 90% of those are broken pieces of pottery.
No, but
good pieces of pottery.
There's wonderful for us, for archaeologists, but...
No, but there are a lot of good pieces not on display.
Yeah, that's
right.
True.
That's my point.
I can only answer that our collection is fully accessible. You know, it's accessible in part because it's on view and rotating installations, but it is available through curatorial departments, and it's available in part on the web. But every object is accessible. No object is hidden away, forgotten, or neglected. Why do we acquire certain things? We acquire things to bring them into the public domain. Otherwise, I'm in the business of taking private things public, you know, for the sake of the people and the preservation of them for all of time. So that's the only reason one continues to acquire, and that is to bring them into a context in which they have greater value of meaning than if they are left privately alone. I know you're a collector of coins, but I have no ambition to encourage collecting privately, but every ambition to encourage bringing things into the public domain.
Okay, I think we started a little bit late, and I want to be. I would propose that we carry on for two more questions, and then continue a private discussion in about 10 minutes. No, well.
Why don't you let the people who got in before the door
close? Fine. So okay. We'll just move briskly then.
Just a quick question. I know you're probably
closer.
Aware, but in England, the Treasure Act allows members of the general public to go search for items, you know, that could be considered cultural property. Do you approve of this idea of just anybody off the street being able to go dig up items that could be, you know, really valuable to our knowledge?
I mean, Gil's the expert, but I wouldn't agree. I mean, you want these things to be excavated by scientists, by professionals, not treasure hunters, because the object may be found, but the context in which it was found may be destroyed.
What he said.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Margaret Musgrave, and I know, Mr. Cuno, you just said that you feel like it's your responsibility to bring objects from the private domain into the public domain. But do you believe that antiquities markets should exist, and if do you think that there are responsibilities to private collectors?
Well, in one respect, I think a legal market in antiquities can exist, and that is that those objects that once excavated and published, some portion of them can be shared with the world, and a means of sharing them might be through a legal trade. It is the way that once partage made accessible objects once excavated. In that sense, I mean, I'm in the business, public business. I'm not in the private business, so it's hard for me to encourage the private collecting of things. That said, you know, in the United States, our public collections are built through private philanthropy of works of art and gifts of money with which we then purchase works of art. So it is a very close relationship that our public institutions have with private individuals. So as long as these things don't encourage looting, if they can be documented of a legal activity, I'd be inclined, but I would want those things to end up in the public domain. Of course, not everything is worthy of that. There will be some things that can circulate privately to the pleasure of the individuals who own them, I suppose. But it is really the distinction between legal and illegal that has to be maintained, I think.
I also have a quick question for you, sir. Along the lines of accessibility, it's been mentioned elsewhere, and I want to bring it up here as well. The issue with an encyclopedic museum and, you know, an argument against retentionist national laws, it's really about 2 decades old, because today we deal with the digital age. Most high school students who are going to encounter an object are going to do so on the internet, and the more objects that are displayed from your museum online and are accessible that way, the more people are going to be aware of them, which thereby basically means that you don't need to have those objects all in one place, as they can be digitally displayed all in one location otherwise. And my second question, basically, is when is the Art Institute going to make the acquisition policy 100% public? Thanks.
Okay. When is the Art Institute going to make its acquisition policy 100% public? I'll go to the first question, and that is about, and I'll come to the second question. But the first question in the order, questions in the order which they were asked. The internet is extremely important for conveying information. It can't convey all the information. It can only convey an image of something. And that thing itself has dimensions of meaning and information in addition to its image, in its terms of its size, its material, its presence. That's one reason one wants to see such things in place. Because if it were true that only the image mattered, it wouldn't matter where the object was. So things, I'll just finish, I'm sorry, unless you want to interrupt.
I was just going to ask about 3D scanning.
Yeah, but still, do you get a sense of the texture and the feel and the weight and the size and scale? They get reduced down to different, to more or less the same size depends on your machine on which you're looking at, or the machine that you have. So I do think there's a real difference in that. But if there weren't a difference in that, it wouldn't matter that something was in Chicago or something was in Delhi, right? So the thing could be here that Delhi wants to have in Delhi, because they would have equal access to it as we, so why does it matter, should we return it to Delhi? So I think that isn't a sufficient argument. And equally, that the benefit of having some set of things in a museum is that you can go easily from one to the next and see them in a different set of context. Whereas when you have them on your screen, you can only reduce the scale of it to fit onto a screen. You might be able to different thumbnails and adding them all up. It is not simply the same. In terms of our acquisition policy, you know, I'll tell you what our acquisition policy is, and I can't frankly tell you if it's online or not, but you might look to see if it is online. Our acquisition policy, and I assume you're talking about antiquities, or you're talking about anything and everything, is we can't buy anything that we can't be confident we have clear title in. Pure, simple, stop.
And what is their title?
That it was not removed illegally from its presumed country of origin. We have to have evidence that something was taken. Now, what is the trail back to its purchase? And how did it come to the hands of the person who's offering it to us? If we can't be confident, I know you might say, you probably are skeptical, but if we can't be confident, we simply can't do it.
A question more specifically to Mr. Tortolero. When you suggested for repatriation that we give them back to nations, what constitutes a nation? For example, the Kurds don't really have their own country, you know, by many reasonable standards, but are their own ethnicity and think of themselves as their own people. Would you allow them the same five artifact limit? And also, are the Elgin marbles one artifact, or are they many? I mean, they all pertain to the same site, the Parthenon, but they're all their own individual pieces.
I would say that's one item, okay, the Elgin marbles. And two, in terms of, okay, your first question was, what was it again? Say it again.
Whether or not people's...
Oh, yes. Well, for example, in the United States, we have laws to protect the rights of the Native Americans. They're really not, you know, countries per se, but they're still culture groups. Oh, I'm saying that, you know, in the United States, there are laws that would, for there, where we protect the stuff that belongs to Native Americans. So to me, if the Kurds want them back and they have a place to put it, it goes back, no problem.
Hi. My name is Beatriz Badikian-Gartler, and I just have a comment for Mr. Cuno. You talk about encyclopedic museums, and you talk about accessibility and having the art for the public, and I just wonder why then it is so expensive to go to the Art Institute of Chicago.
I was waiting for that one.
I can tell you that 65% of our the people who come to the museum do not pay, and 35% who do come subsidize the 65% who don't come, and there is a price that makes that possible. So children under the age of 14 don't pay, school teachers don't pay, all the state of Illinois school teachers. Active duty, policemen, and military don't pay. You come on Thursday nights, it's free. You come in the month of February, it's free. 65% of the people who come to the Art Institute of Chicago do not pay at the door. 35% of the people do. They pay a certain price that makes possible our subsidizing the 65% who don't pay. It's just a matter of finances.
Well, I you've already gotten started, but I'd like to ask you to join me in thanking our panelists and to...